same time, American universities are beginning to globalize in new ways, which we will hear from today, with many more jobs requiring international work teams. Universities are preparing their STEM students by providing more international experience through study abroad and other cross-border collaborations. Universities are also modifying their STEM curricula to better prepare students for jobs that will stay in America. In some respects, American universities have been global for many, many years. We have attracted large numbers of foreign students, particularly in STEM fields at the graduate level. But offshoring is giving high quality foreign students outstanding job opportunities in their home countries. This makes it less, right, may make it less likely that foreign students will stay in the U.S. after graduation, and may make it less desirable to come to the U.S. to study in the first place. Therefore, American universities are taking their education to the foreign students by building campuses and offering STEM degree programs in other countries. Today, we'll hear from what our witnesses have to say about the trends, motivations, and consequences of globalization of universities on our U.S. science and engineering enterprise, its workforce, and our nation's competitiveness. With that, I'd like to now recognize my friend and colleague, ranking member, Mr. Hunter from Texas, for opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. You've done very well. I'm delighted that the member of the general was out before she migrated over to the willingness to give. Significant work numbers work for American firms after maybe this should provide a certain diversity as maybe it's just going to be the hardest and stimulate growth either within the current country. Finally, I think we should also consider the role that international rankings have in further projecting America's image. Many of these programs are located in areas of the world where the U.S. has a strategic interest and on the ground. These are some questions that I think Bob and you will answer and I look forward to hearing them. I do look forward to the testimony of Bob Captain to continue this discussion during the question, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. As this discussion is committed by the members of which I offer an opening sentence for the record, we will accept the image of the records. Again, I'm very delighted to this extremely distinguished and accomplished panel of experts here to remind us. Dr. David Scorton is president of Cornell University. Dr. Gary Schuster is provost and vice president of academic affairs at Georgia Institute of Technology. Mr. Mark Wilson is dean of the Clark School of Public Policy at Carnegie Mellon University. Dr. Philip Altbach is professor of higher education and director of the Center for International Higher Education at Boston College. Thank you, gentlemen, very much for being here. As we discuss the classical panelists in the committee, as you allow 5 minutes of testimony, I'd like to brief for something as important. That would be followed by a very big indicator, which is one of the on your table there that illustrates when your time is running low. And as many different Dr. Mayers used to say, past 5 minutes of trap door emergency and you disappear. Something you wish you had in faculty minutes, I'm sure. Please, we'll begin with Dr. Scorton. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Chairman Baird. Thank you, everyone, all the members of the community. My name is David Scorton, and I'm president of Cornell University. I want to start, Mr. Baird, by saying that Dr. Cornell does not have a position on Texas history at the alum. Cornell is located in Hickory, New York, with campuses or programs in New York City, Geneva, New York, Apple Bear Island, Maine, Singapore, Puerto Rico, France, England, Italy, Singapore, China, Tanzania, Cairo, and 45 other countries as Cornell abroad destinations. He's not only the largest and most comprehensive school in the Ivy League, and he's also a library at the University of New York State. Our enrollment is approximately 20,000 with students from every state, and more than 3,000 students from 120 other countries studying under internationally renowned faculty. We are one of the most international of American universities. I thank you for having me there and for inviting me to share one university's perspective on globalization of research, development, and innovation. You've asked us to address three questions. The first regarding our motivations and decision factors in establishing overseas branch campuses. The second, how internationalization impacts the global research enterprise. And the third, how we prepare our students to compete in a globalized marketplace. The most important message that I want to emphasize today is the enormous role higher education plays and can play in intercultural exchange and thereby in American diplomacy. I firmly believe that international education, research, and capacity building are one of our country's most effective diplomatic assets. I will answer each of the committee's questions in detail in my written statement and two appendices, but will summarize the key points for you now. First, the Wild Cornell Medical College in Denmark, Qatar, is the first American medical school to offer RandD overseas. In 2001, we were invited to establish this campus by the government of Qatar through the Qatar Foundation for Education, Science, and Community Development in Education City, which also houses campuses at Virginia Commonwealth University, Georgetown University, Texas A&M University, and Carnegie Mellon University. As with all of our long-term academic alliances with international entities, we ask ourselves two key questions. One, what makes the relationship worth pursuing? And two, what will make the relationship work? The guiding principle is always twofold. The benefits must be compelling, and the risks must be manageable. And we made public in the appendix to my comments the exact check sheet that we have used in negotiating and considering other branch campus or joint degree activities. I now saw the Cutter Foundation's invitation as an opportunity for students from the Middle East to obtain quality medical education in their own region, to improve the quality of health care in that region. In addition, we saw an unprecedented opportunity for our faculty to teach and understand another country and to broaden their research to investigate the unique medical problems of the region. The Cutter Foundation assumes all the expenses of a building operating a school, and we estimate that to be $750 million over the first decade of operation. We are looking forward to awarding the first medical degrees in Belmont in the spring of 2008, and we will be carefully monitoring the success of the degree candidates on standardized tests and on employment placements as two measures to gauge the rigor of the program. Second question, it is not clear what the effect of our branch campuses would be on the global science and technology enterprise, as Mr. Orr mentioned. It is still too early and too many variables. But while globalization may be a new concept in the public rhetoric, quite a lot of these schools have a long history of internationalization, in our case going back to our first international students in 1868, and all of our colleges and professional schools and nearly every program on campus. Based on this long experience, we know that any cooperation across borders can play an important role in promoting cross-cultural understanding, and that real and substantial benefits accrue to the U.S. and to the process of innovation, the driver of our global economic competitiveness. Third question, much of what we do as a university is, of course, aimed at ensuring the success of our graduates. In this regard, we are responding to the demands of our students and STEM fields for instruction in critical needs languages, such as Arabic, Mandarin, Russian, Hindi, and Farsi, which are among the more than 40 languages taught at Cornell. We encourage students to study abroad, and we have created internationally focused undergraduate programs, such as a new major in China and Asia-Pacific Studies, which is designed to train leaders and help to negotiate the delicate complexities of U.S.-China operations. Just as important as sending students overseas, Cornell welcomes thousands of international students each year. These students contribute to the diversity of the campus, to the community, and to the education of all students. Our international graduates who stay in this country, especially in science and engineering fields, help fill a crying need for scientific and technical talent not currently being filled by American students. Those who return home often maintain contact with Cornell or other American colleagues, laying the foundation for continuing collaboration. In addition, our many international collaborations help prepare Cornell students for a place in the global economy by addressing problems and issues in which both societies have a stake. I want to make the committee aware that in keeping with the conversation with the U.S. Prime Minister in January, Cornell will be working with other U.S. universities and Indian counterpart institutions to create a faculty-led Indo-U.S. working group to develop joint research agendas and critical challenges of interest to both nations. In concluding my remarks, I want you to consider, please, the concept of universities as the catalyst for capacity building in the developing world. The initiatives aimed at strengthening competitiveness of education and STEM disciplines, both from this committee's leadership and from the administration, are pointing this designation in the right direction. But just as you are right to be concerned about the U.S. losing ground potentially to China and India, we must also be concerned about the socioeconomic inequalities that threaten our country and our world. Universities are perfectly positioned to play the central role that the Marshall Plan did 60 years ago in New York through aid and joint planning. The nation's great research universities, working with governments, the private sector, NGOs, and our colleagues overseas, can offer a more focused application of our own resources to improve the quality of life here on ground. Truly great. Thank you again for inviting me to participate. And please to answer any questions the committee may have. Brian Baird, Ranking Member Bob, members of the House Committee on Science and Technology. I am the Provost of Georgia Institute of Technology, and I am honored to speak about Georgia Tech's overseas programs. Georgia Tech's international activities fall under the rubric of its mission, which is to define the technological research university of the 21st century and educate the leaders of a technology-driven world. Recognizing that innovation increasingly happens all around the globe, we are developing mutually beneficial research and education platforms overseas with high-quality international partners whose research and educational interests align with ours. In selecting the locations and partners for these platforms, Georgia Tech's
serves a number of core principles. Platforms are chosen to provide a strategic advantage for Georgia Tech, and they have a research-driven and clear educational benefit for our own students. They operate within the parameters of the laws of the United States and Georgia, as well as of the host nation. The activities must preserve the quality and integrity of Georgia Tech's reputation. Finally, we strive to operate them in a self-supporting and revenue-neutral manner relative to our other operations. Our oldest and largest international campus is Georgia Tech Lorraine in Paris, France, which was founded in 1990. It includes research as well as graduate and undergraduate education programs. The unique research unit joint between Georgia Tech Lorraine and the French National Center for Scientific Research, which is the largest and most influential research agency in Europe, allows us to collaborate with French researchers and gives us early access to technology being developed in France. As an example, because France has a high level of expertise in aspects of network security, we stand to gain from what we can learn from this partnership to benefit the state of Georgia and the United States. Finally, Singapore, where Georgia Tech also has a research and education program, is more advanced in some aspects of transportation logistics than the United States is, and we can benefit from our partnership there. This program includes research and logistics funded by Singapore government agencies and their first master's degree in the region in logistics and supply chain management. In addition to the unique partnership, the unique research opportunities provided through the on-farm partnerships, our students also benefit from these relationships. As one of the nation's top 10 public universities and its largest producer of engineers, we focus on educating graduates who understand technology in a global context. The nature of science and engineering curricula make study abroad difficult to accommodate. But our international platforms help us offer a wide array of opportunities. More than a third of our undergraduates study or work abroad. 17 of our undergraduate degree programs offer international designation. This means special courses and overseas experience add a global context to their field of study, and that fact is noted on their diplomas. Our graduates are highly sought after by employers, and our alumni report that the international aspects of their education add value to their career. Georgia Tech also works closely with the state of Georgia in economic development, and our international programs provide a point of access for the state to develop international trade and investment relationships. For example, in 2005, the President of Lorraine and the Governor of Georgia signed a formal agreement under which Georgia Tech Lorraine will serve as a facilitator for a business-to-business conference. Georgia Tech's international activities have also attracted foreign corporate research labs to Atlanta to locate adjacent to our campus. In summary, our international platforms enable Georgia Tech to be a partner and collaborator in research discoveries happening in other parts of the world and make our faculty and students citizens of the world. Thank you for the opportunity to testify before the committee. I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Sister. Thanks very much. So, the webinar's question will be joined by a fellow Georgian who will answer the question. Mr. Weiss, go ahead.
Chairman Barrett, I can remember a lot of members of the committee. Thank you very much for this opportunity to submit my thoughts on the topic of the university role in the globalization of international research, education, and development. It's a consuming issue for almost every major American university campus today. One might legitimately wonder why you think the policy schools testifying before a committee on science and technology. I guess I have two answers to that question. One is that quite a lot of we think of policy as a science as well as an art. But the other is that we also, probably half of what we do at high school involves information technology management, both in our research and education programs. And if these programs more than any other, we have to include in the globalization efforts at the high school.
globalization, while I believe it to be tremendously beneficial impact for our institutions and for the United States economy, does challenge us to answer critical questions about the impact of our efforts on the American economy, the effect on the generation of new technology and innovation for our citizens, and our obligations as institutions to people, countries, societies, and economic systems beyond our borders. What's new generally, in my opinion, about what's happening is that American universities have always had a strong international connection with faculty from research and our student body. Today, universities are engaged in the issue of becoming global institutions as part of our overall strategies. There are many forces driving this, but I see three primary forces. One is, of course, the increasing globalization of economic and policy activity around the world. The second is that the American tertiary education system has been globally recognized as a driver of economic success, and increasingly governments and businesses are coming to us from around the world to access that expertise. And finally, there are clearly competitive forces in our industry, which increasingly require us to be entrepreneurial to support the kind of quality of research and education which has been earning pressure on for decades. Beyond these general forces, what any university or college chooses to do on this front is a manifestation of that institution's particular circumstances, capabilities, and values. My university has made great strides in becoming a global institution. In 1997, one of the study abroad programs, we offered only one academic program outside the United States. Today, we offer 12 different degree programs in 10 countries and have institution building joint degree programs in formal collaborative research activities in Singapore, Taiwan, India, China, and Portugal. Additionally, we have official presences which can be characterized as branch campuses in Greece, Canada, Japan, and Australia. And that list is growing, and I expect it to grow in the future. It's important to point out that there's no single model that's optimal as an instrument to achieve our goals. We evaluate every global opportunity according to its ability to support us in achieving the following objectives. Building alignment with the important organizations and individuals who are leaders in the global economy and policy environment. Reaching new student markets that are unlikely to access our education by coming to Pittsburgh. Create opportunities for existing students to expand their professional education through integrated professional experiences abroad. Improve our curriculum by broadening our exposure to global policy and business issues. Build a globally aware faculty with an institutional environment capable of supporting intellectual inquiry into the emerging issues posed by globalization. And finally, to create new sources of revenue that can support our activities both abroad and at home. You rightly ask what outcomes we expect from our efforts to become global institutions. This is a new activity and a bold activity for institutions like mine. Nevertheless, we have some expectations. We expect increased recognition around the world of the potential constructive impact of our institution on the efforts of societies to fulfill the aspirations of their people and a consequent increase in our brand equity. We expect increased financial support for our efforts from both public and private sector entities that will convince with this funding. We expect the ability to deliver education to highly qualified students who we would not have been able to serve previously. We expect improved quality of education for all of our students as we modify our curriculum to reflect global learning partnerships around the world and provide opportunities for true professional development in these contexts. We expect better research and innovation outcomes as we expand our reach to include new intellectuals from around the world. And we expect the ability to experiment with and learn from new models and models for research and education in our highly decentralized and distributed environment. And now I'd like to briefly take a moment to address an important issue which I know has been a concern to the committee. As universities become more global, we are effectively, if unintentionally, increasing the capacity of firms and individuals abroad to do jobs currently done here in the United States. That's an arguable point, but it's my opinion that although this effect is likely to be quite small, it deserves an honest answer, and that honest answer is that it probably is so. Nevertheless, I think that it is also my opinion that in aggregate, the benefits to the U.S. economy and to American workers from our activity far exceeds the cost. Ultimately, our global efforts will create jobs in the United States through improved education and innovation in our institutions. Without taking too much time, I believe the benefits will come in four primary forms. New innovation is a result of our ability to build a vibrant network of intellectuals drawing on high-paying capital individuals around the globe. Graduates who are better trained to lead innovation in global
business and policy enterprises of this nature. More resources generated through our international efforts to support our institutions as a whole. And better, more outward-looking universities that are more connected to business and society and have a greater ability to transfer knowledge outside their walls. In my view, this globalization effort is simply a part of a broader movement in academia to reach out and become more engaged with companies, governments, and societies, and to be more directly concerned about the responsiveness of our efforts to the needs of society. As evidence of this, Carnegie Mellon has not only gone abroad, it's gone to the West Coast. We now have a West Coast campus in the Bay Area in response to that Bay Area's technologists on the hot bank there. And my school, the high school, has a new campus in Los Angeles to respond to the film industry. And we'll have opened up a new campus in Washington, D.C. within a year to be more tied to our national policy mechanism. Perhaps I persuaded you, but perhaps not. The one thing I would like to say in closing is that, given their mention, the economist report that had 17 of the top 20 global universities coming from the United States. But we don't need the competition. If we ask what happens if we don't do this, I think the answer for us as institutions is actually quite great. In 20 years, if we do not seriously pursue globalization, I think you can easily expect half of the institutions that we see today in the top 20 to drop out. This will ultimately provide serious damage both to the U.S. economy and the U.S. political system. Thank you very much. Chairman Baird, ranking members, all my colleagues, my role this morning is to provide a bit of another perspective. I'm not here to talk about the efforts of my own university in internationalization, but to provide a broad perspective on what I think some of the key issues are. As my colleagues have said, the future of universities, of the excellent universities around the world, is a global future. There is no question about that. And if we as institutions and if we as states and the nation don't take this seriously, we are going to fail in the future. So that's key. We need to be globally competitive in higher education. Universities have always been international and global institutions. From medieval universities, which use, we should remember, a common language of instruction, Latin, and which attracted foreign students and faculty, they didn't call them that in those days, they were truly global institutions. The United States, in fact, if you look at our higher education system, we have imported models from all around the world. Our university system is based really on three ideas. The British Colonial College, the German Research University of the 19th century, and the truly American idea of university service to society. Those are the three key elements that have shaped American higher education. And I should say, shaped the world's higher education today, because the American university is the global model. If you look around the world, and we see every day, but frequently, colleagues from different countries are coming to our universities and finding out how we do it. Because we, in our higher education industry, are the gold standard today. So that's very important. A few definitions, which I think are important, because we may be about globalization, internationalization, and so on, and we often don't define them carefully. What I mean, and many scholars have talked about globalization to me, are the broad economic and social trends that affect the world environment, including, of course, information technology, the growing role and use of the English language, which I think gives us in the U.S. a very significant advantage internationally in higher education, worldwide demand for access, and so on. These are factors over which we have little control and which are part of the broader environment. What I mean by internationalization, and my colleagues have talked about aspects of this morning, are the specific policies of governments, universities, schools, colleges, and even people to adapt, define, and contribute to this global environment. Academic institutions, as well as states and nations, have different ideas about adapting to the global environment. And I would say, as a comparative educator, that if you look around the world, our major national competitors deeply in
engaged in an academic foreign policy are ahead of us in the U.S. in terms of thinking about their approaches, national approaches to higher education, exports to higher education policy in a global environment. What's meant by multinationalization? And here is where branch campuses are coming. Multinationalization encompasses academic programs and institutions, including the branch campuses, that are offered by academic institutions in one country in another. Some people have called this McDonaldization, and part of it is franchising in truly McDonald's fashion. Now, that's not what the university is representing at this table, too, but there is some of that around the world, and it's important to watch because all of the global trends, the international trends, are not of tremendously high quality today. Let me mention a few things, a few kind of one particular case study that I know is of interest to this committee, and that's the interesting issue of branch campuses. There are, according to the rather incomplete research, at least 82 branch campuses that operate today around the world, and the number is probably significantly higher than that. The United States is the largest single country that contributes to the branch campus phenomenon, with approximately half. Branch campuses are largely a north to south phenomenon. That is, universities in rich countries are opening branch campuses in developing and middle income countries. Most branch campuses worldwide, with very few exceptions, operate in English overseas, even from countries like the Netherlands, which is not an English-speaking country. Their branch campuses operate largely in English. With the opening of China and India, both highly complicated regulatory environments today, the branch campus phenomenon is likely to become even more important. What are the motivations, very briefly, to centers? To earn money. That's part of it. To build a brand image overseas. To help you recruit students from other countries to come to the home campus. To provide a destination for study abroad for our students. And broadly as part of an internationalization strategy. And finally, a couple of problems. The failure to earn money is a problem. The University of New South Wales in Australia just recently closed its branch campus in Singapore after less than a year, and the expenditure of a very large amount of Australian money and, by the way, Singapore money to the close enrollments were not what they wanted. The failure to maintain the standards of the home campus abroad, again, the institutions at this table would not be part of that phenomenon. But it's there. It's important. How do we get our own faculty to go abroad to teach for periods of time? Difficulties of dealing with host governments and institutions. Regulatory environments overseas are quite difficult. Managing quality control at this end of things through our accrediting system, which is used and very effective in contributing to quality assessment and control within the United States, is less able to do that abroad. Well, these are some of the issues, and I hope I've provided at least a little bit of perspective to get our discussion going in this morning. Thank you.
Thank all the witnesses for this fascinating and stimulating discussion on very intriguing topic. That's what I actually hope to show your commitment to. Role of universities and academic environment in international collaboration and understanding. And one of my goals as chair of the Secretary of Research and Education is the concept of science diplomacy, finding ways where we can bridge gaps that may emerge in politics, religion, culture, etc. Science and academic endeavor can bring people together. Dr. Schuster, I also appreciate very much your insights. We tend to look at this as, oh my goodness, American universities are getting something valuable that is uniquely American away to the other countries. I think you pointed out well that there are many countries that actually do things better than us, and we can learn from our presence there that benefits us because we're not just getting our vast career about a very universal field, the way in which workplaces may behave us, which we tend to forget sometimes here. But Mr. Russell, I should agree that the policy is both science and art, and art here on the nature of where it's more of a fact than art. The historical effects of work taken. This isn't the impact necessarily of the immediate windmill phenomenon. But one of the questions I have for you about this, I have come to appreciate the incredible value that has been derived to our society from foreign students who have come here and gained their undergraduate and graduate degrees and then go back to home country with not only knowledge that they serve their own country with, but in many of most cases, I think a deep affection for our country. As we establish branch campuses overseas, will we see a decline in the number of foreign students who come here, and hence a potential indirect decline in that kind of emotional tie to our own nation that carries all sorts of benefits? Any thoughts on that?
Let me answer first, and that's something that is of interest and a little bit of concern to us if we're in Georgia Tech. In the programs that we are establishing abroad, particularly the graduate programs of the master's and the PhD, a part of the curriculum expects those students to spend a semester or a year on the Atlanta campus for exactly the purpose that you identified, is to give them an experience in the American Research University. We believe that that will strengthen the ties and expand our ability to build relationships in the science and diplomacy around the world. It's hard to say at this stage, but the early evidence that we have is actually quite promising on this. We opened a campus in Kobe, Japan about 2 years ago, and I've seen at my school applications from Japanese government officials and private sector folks actually increase as a result of the increased visibility that we have. We never have Australian students on the campus, and because we've developed campus at this point, because we've developed an integrated curriculum across our two campuses. We now have students going back and forth between those two campuses, and we now have Australian students in Pittsburgh and U.S. students taking part in their studies abroad. So I actually am cautiously optimistic about the impact on this learning. Actually, I'm highly optimistic that there would not be a decline in international student numbers coming to the U.S. If you look at the projections in the out years, the demand for international higher education, be it from students who want to go to a different country, and there are many motivations for people who want to go to different countries, including immigration, which is going to continue. Those numbers seem to be quite significant. So I think the establishment of branch campuses of American universities overseas will not affect overall student numbers coming here, and may, as my colleagues have said, actually improve the quality of students coming to this country because they know better what they're getting into and have an exposure already to U.S. higher education. I might point out one other thing slightly related to your question, and that is if you look at student number, overseas student enrollments over a long period of time in the U.S., you'll find that very significant numbers have not gone up. And that has benefits to our country. And of course, Americans, policymakers are very concerned about maintaining, in some ways, the numbers from overseas who contribute to SAT in this country. But the big sending countries, India and China, over time, 75% or so of their graduates, this is over 20 years, have remained in the United States after their graduation. So this is a very significant number. And we need to examine what this means for our economy, of course, what it means for their economies as well. And one final bullet point, that is, to me, the big determinant on numbers of foreign students is not branch campuses. It's U.S. policy welcoming, making possible for international students to come to this country, visa restrictions, and all that stuff that you're well aware of. Thank you.
As Jerry Barry has said, we're starting to hear and start to predict, especially about the future. And
Campuses, but we are in labor was
Dr. Schuster will use the revenue network. And the idea would be whatever the price or the sort of operation that has a request, a different kind of expense to train a physician or an engineer than it will be cost to train a subway in humanities discipline or social science discipline. But I think in general, we have to operate on the idea that we will be revenue neutral. And so overall, whatever the cost of education is, we have to find a way to retire that. I think I know this material I'm describing why I think that the cost of paying for higher education in this country is a complicated quasi growth of the tuition grant, which does not cover other costs. Philanthropy, enormous public investment, at Cornell and private university, we have $1 billion in public money a year in the form of research grants, student aid, money from the state of New York. And so this combination of tuition, grants, contracts, philanthropy, and other procedures are have to go up to a non-profit bottom line. So in general, the costs have to be borne, but the various weighting of those factors, how much would be for the different factors and different campuses would depend on the discipline, the cost, and the overall capability of the institution.
Okay, reading and hearing, maybe you can share it back out as an educating cost of sending your youngsters to school and development that they sign it for. You know, that when it's in the fourth or fifth grade, they are looking ahead for the academic situation for some of us Americans who now don't to, you know, school there and get that attend there. Would that be one way of us cutting down on the escalating cost of graduating from, say, Cornell?
Yes, I know. Yes, I know.
Yes, that's not a fair question.
I think it is, though. Yes, so certainly American students are often many of these campuses, although the idea, of course, is to establish a footprint in another society. We do have work to do in higher education on the balance between the cost control and debt funding. And just because I've gone off the floor, and I'll say very quickly in 30 seconds, it's a three-part solution to the problem that you've raised. We need commitment from the other members of our elected officials to make sure that public money continues to go to student aid in this country. We cannot fail to do that no matter where the economic challenges may lie. Secondly, we have a long way left to help us with philanthropy. But thirdly, I don't know how to do a better job of cost containment going forward in this event, but my colleagues, I know how to do a better job of cost containment.
And I tell you, we're better back from this bank in London. And my last question, I don't expect an answer from it, is for a state institution or a state, who do you consider to be out of state? Well, I would go out there and be about my clients.
Mr. Johnson,
I can hear you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Hall always comes up with the hardest of the questions.
I happen to be in the state government last week when we were here, and I saw a group of students that maybe I've been really listening to a panel, and I decided to go out and listen to the kids. And I found it pretty fascinating what their insight was. And a group of young folks that I met with, and I said, you know, that group over there, and I don't think it's a program, and I don't think what their vision is, and how come we succeed. Really, it's about the students and what they can get out of it, and what we would like to see happen. Into the future as far as I'm concerned. And I was wondering about, because what we see happening with other nations building their own universities, and they're beginning to build branches in the United States from their universities, if you're aware of.
And very briefly, there are rumors that a couple of Mexican universities are opening or planning to open branch campuses in Hispanic areas in the United States to serve Spanish-speaking students in the U.S., but those are so far unconfirmed. The short answer to the question is no. It's an interesting broader policy issue, actually, because in my view, there isn't much potential. In other words, the higher education environment in the United States is so complex and so, generally speaking, good and so varied across sectors. It would be difficult for an international
foreign institution to copy our later success of it. The British Open University actually tried a few years ago with using their brand of distance education to come into the university field. So I think that would be the answer to that.
I'm happy to have put the example that you said earlier. It's just not an example of North-South. It's just that you explained a minute ago. Do you mind if
I I don't know that they've actually set up branches here, but I know we have a relationship with the technological area in Mexico, and we have very assiduously pursued student markets, particularly in the Southwest United States, for their programs, including the partnership with some U.S. institutions.
Are you having the kinds of difficulties with students when it comes to the time they visit your branch, needs to spend time here, back to the United States? How difficult is it for them to receive the visas necessary and the most documents necessary for them to come?
I can't speak directly to the specific cohort of students who will be coming from ranch campuses, but I think everybody at this table, and I suspect that everybody in the room is aware of some of the challenges that higher education is faced in being able to have visa issued in the economy and grant to appropriate students and any assistance to them might be hard to us in resolving that problem.
Has it had an impact on the financing of our universities, both on the Commonwealth and on the Commonwealth?
First of all, I'd like to submit two questions. The one question, as my colleagues have said, about the accessibility of the U.S. to international scholars and students continues to be an area of concern. Trying to decide exactly where to find a sweet spot, but I think the pendulum swung a certain distance before and immediately after 9/11. It swung back. We've had a lot of terrific dialogue with the higher education community, with the Department of Homeland Security, and with the State Department. I know you can get the National Security Higher Education Advisory Board, which is a pretty brand new work with the FBI. There's been 20 university presidents that have brought on a whole plan of that was to initiate bringing dialogue. So I think things are going in the right direction. The branch campuses are a special case. It's a small number of students relative to the large number of international students who come here. And we have it set up in advance as a prescribed program. So, for example, we have students right now in the summer in Ithaca, New York, and in New York City at the medical school of Cornell Medical College from the medical school of preeminence program and for international students. And we have been able to do that. So, two separate questions. I think focused approaches to programs where it's clear the local time student is going to be staying its own 130 at a time. We don't have cooperation, it's been more manageable. The overall issue of visas and so on, still trying to find what the right balance is, a difficult problem.
Topic China has built a significant number of many universities. There's an attracting a lot of those students across the countries. Is something for us to worry about? Do you have any comment that you advise that we ought to be looking at as a Congress to change the aspect of that?
Which I can reflect on that. China and India, too, are beginning to have strategies to attract students from other countries to those countries. My own view is that they will not be tremendously successful. Issues of quality of higher education, language questions, ease of study, the attractiveness of those countries, and so on, are such that it would be a bit difficult for them to attract the numbers that they seem to be thinking about. So far, there isn't much going on in their area, but there will be, and we should be careful to monitor. My own view is, so long as U.S. institutions maintain their quality, maintain their attractiveness, and maintain their general excellence overall, we will do very well in international competition in higher education. We start with a huge advantage. Our issue here is to maintain that advantage. We're at a good place if we continue to be the
all of the issues to support the institutions to provide rational access in terms of immigration and visas and that sort of thing would do well. I'm pretty optimistic about that. There is a lot of competition out there. The Australians, the British, the New Zealanders, they particularly at the present time have a big competition. They're doing pretty well. They have some problems. Australia, particularly right now, which I think overinvested in, didn't take the care that they needed to in establishing some of their overseas tournament and branch campuses and franchising. So now it's going to be back to bite them a little bit. But so long as we maintain our excellence and attractiveness, we will be fine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Several years ago, we had an exchange student in our house from Turkmenistan. While he was with us, the Turkmen embassy, the guy that ran Turkmenistan, closed all the hospitals in Turkmenistan and said if they were sick, they could come to the Turkmen. And there's no idea about where this guy comes from. I said to him, so how long does it take to get from your town married to the Turkmen? It's like 2 hours. So, if you might have the conditions, maybe in Turkmenistan, but if you have a heart attack and marry, and you need to get to the capital, it's 2 hours away. The last month he was with us, he came into my home office at my house, and I said, sir, I want to come back. He said, it is possible in this country for American people to send their children to college. In my country, it is not possible. So, we have to come back. First, it's quite a showstopper for me. Last night, I had to get back off my wife saying, what am I going to see our heart? Because we just got an email from him saying, they helped me. It cost me $2,600 a year and $150 a month to go to the American University of Central Asia. And we had 5 kids, and one's finished college, one's in college, one's going next year. So my wife says, maybe we can help Sarah. I suppose that Sarah, in some ways, is the way that fits some of this. It's a way of offering them an opportunity. Is the goal to make it more cost effective for people to expand the reach of your universities or both? I think everybody is moved by short stories. Just related. And the truth is, I think most of us are thousands and thousands of those stories of qualified and ambitious individuals who are just looking for an opportunity to. And part of our motivation is to provide those opportunities for them. I want to come back to this question of what is it that attracts foreign students to American universities and what is it that we're trying to propagate by moving some of our operations offshore. And it comes down to two important issues, I believe, quality and culture. And it's been said by my colleagues here, and I thank you very much for the compliments. By characterizing American universities as the gold standard and one of the best in the world, I think that is certainly true and is well recognized. And the question becomes, of course, well, what is it that drives that? What is it that makes the American universities recognized globally as the leader? And why is it that I think personally that universities established in India, whether they be quadruple the number or in China, will not become competitive quickly in the ISIS culture. And I think that the opportunity to succeed in a meritocracy rather than a culture of hierarchy is one of the great strengths of the American university. It's open. It is a competition of ideas, whether of age or of birth or of status or of color. And I think that the examples of history that inform us of that, the American universities have been the entry point for American immigrants to the United States to gain an education and to become successful and leading citizens. And part of our objective in moving offshore is to provide that opportunity for us, like the one that you're describing in the country. Visa is a challenge, as many of you are getting the opportunity to come. I think we can get the visa, right? It is relatively open. That's my impression, is that it's like
is obviously more expensive than being educated at the American University of St. Louis. I think that he's got the price for it in terms of some of the housing in our custom PPIs above. But still, it's a large sum of money if you're in real estate. So I just wanted to make one connection on this issue of students coming here. One of the primary reasons students come to universities in America is to access the U.S. labor market. They certainly come from trade that we offer from the schools of management, but it is much easier for them to get jobs in U.S. companies through being in school here than if they do their study abroad. One of the problems on the visa side that I see is not so much student visas, although that could be an issue, but the reliability of our system to provide work visas for highly talented foreign nationals actually influences the choices people make when they decide where they're going to go to college. And that's been a much more highly variable phenomenon, particularly over the last few years. It's a very difficult question, for instance, Dr. Scorpion and others, but I think it's really important for us to pay attention to.
Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to include any of our official grants in the next part of this case. So that the material is up our side. We appreciate that your support for the outstanding panel and recognize Mr. McKay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank God for putting that in this morning. I don't know your business schedule, so it just seems to be very interesting and enlightening. Dr. Scorpion, have you found a need to create private institutions or private entities to carry out the creating overseas institutions and to operate on those institutions?
You mean creating a separate from private university?
Private institutions that could be associated in some way with private, but yes, separate.
No, we haven't been. If you had a chance on your staff to look at our checklist and appendix that I put in my prepared remarks, we may put up exactly what sort of due diligence we do. We're trying to figure this out. We've been quite open about it. We're sure that other universities who have thought about going, for example, into education, city, and partner, have been able to do that through the normal mechanisms of the corporate structure of Cornell. But there's a lot of detailed due diligence that goes into that. If you have a chance to write your response, it's laid out in the appendix.
Sure, and now that I've now we're talking about the due diligence, you indicate that there's a need to have a compelling, you want a compelling reason to open up an institution. What sort of framework do you use to make that decision and something's compelling or not?
Well, compelling, by compelling, I mean that there is a rationale in the local context that is worth filling in need, even if it's a comparative need in the culture of society. So, for example, in the case of medical school in Cornell, there was a perceived need, a perceived market, if I can use that term, for an American medical degree in that part of the world. It's the first full-bag institution in Cornell. And as is indicated in the appendix, we have included the right to utilize non-discrimination policies, as we do in the United States and the state of New York, to apply to hiring and to admissions decisions in that culture. So part of it is the bicompatibility that there is a need in the market in which that looks like it would be important, but another compelling need would be on the research side, as Dr. Schuster has said, and I can't emphasize this more too much, the body of studies from the problems that are best studied and certainly find them best studied concurrently. And so that's why I went by the idea of compelling.
Thank you very much for this, Dr. Schuster. Let me add to that with what Dr. Scorpion said. One of the first criteria has to be invited. The work we wanted by the government, by the structure that asks us to be a partner or participant in the foreign country in which we operate. So we don't want to look as though we're colonists or invaders. We want to be invited in. Another criteria is that we want to make sure that we set up an operating environment and operating structure in which we can maintain our quality and our ethics. As Dr. Scorpion said, we will not operate in a way in which we violate our principles. Quite importantly, is the opportunity to take advantage of unique resources or challenges within the country. So, for example, I suspect you are aware of the challenges associated with water quality and water distribution. We have faculty working in Africa and
supply for global wide distribution, advising governments on the Middle East on water quality and water distribution opportunities. And that turns into opportunities for our faculty members to participate in the solutions on those challenging problems the world faces. So, you know, the humanitarian aspect of this decision making is not really what it sounds like. And one of the components in which we weigh the opportunities, I think that many of those at this table, I suspect all of those at this table, will tell you that rarely does a week or a month go by where we don't get an inquiry from someone to the foreign government asking for a partnership at some level. And the phrase that Dr. Arthur practiced with modernization, and that's not a journal that we want to participate in. Which I thought that I'm going to ask you this. You mentioned regulation several times. Could you elaborate on what that means? Or is that too specific to the country in which you're located in?
Yes, it's specific to the countries in which you're located. Each country has a different regulatory environment, or in some cases, no regulatory environment, or in other cases, of thinking it through. And it becomes very complicated for U.S. or other foreign institutions which are thinking of locating a branch campus in any given country. India is a prime example right now. They're thinking through how they want to regulate, how they want to recognize, how they want to permit foreign academic institutions coming in to the country. And China, for a long time, has had the policy of insisting, and I think it's not a bad policy actually, insisting that foreign institutions that wish to come into China must partner with another Chinese institution. They can't do it on their own. And they're thinking of changing that so as to make it possible for freestanding branches to come in. But the point of my comment is that there's a range of different regulatory environments that are changing. Some of them are not exactly corrupt. And institutions which are thinking of going into a country need to be concerned about these matters. I can make a couple of other reactions to points that
I'm going to ask you to reframe the dialogue here. If the opportunity arises, the second is where we're going to ask you to have a lot of good stuff about the conversations. Mr. Chairman, thank you. And the chairman was going to clear my hand with a region of the stream and say, you're not going to try to. Now, I think that was the whole of the week. It's not surprising when I talk about that. I'm going to ask you. It's bad that you used to. Is, and of course, I think said that 75% of the graduates are foreign nationals that come here. On student visas, in graduate programs, master's and PhD programs that remain in the country after they complete their studies. And you know, this is this good and bad. My concern, and what the state says with other panels before this committee, and certainly when I was on the Education Committee in the previous Congress, we talked about the name of the higher ed sections. The main drive and the fact that, you know, they come and they stay and they compete, and maybe they possibly pay a little bit less. It's a disincentive. I'm afraid to sell that. Most environments in this country to proceed STEM education, maybe even when they need to be taken back to the high school level, because you know, lawyers and doctors and certainly not politicians make more money than engineers and pure scientists and chemists and biochemists. I would like you to clean all of the witnesses in the time remaining. I think you'll have to add that, but if you can respond to that, because it is a concern.
First of all, it's, I was talking about China specifically. It's not true that there are many other countries have significantly higher rates of return, even developing countries. Students that have degrees are going to I don't like to refer to anymore to what used to be called the brain drain, because I think that the situation now in the era of globalization. And I'm trying to be really brief because this is a really big issue. It is now much more complicated. And individuals who stay in the United States, especially from rapidly developing countries, increasingly have important relationships back home. And that benefits their economy, and it benefits our economy, and it greatly benefits them. There's much more going back and forth. So, to be brief, although the stay rate is declining modestly, there are going homeless, there are opportunities in their home countries, but even those who remain are much more engaged in the global economy, and that benefits us and it benefits them.
I agree with that. There are some serious pieces of evidence from our experience in this relates to graduate programs in information technology management. There's no evidence that our international student graduates earn less money when they graduate than our domestic student graduates. But if they are treated quite similarly on that scale. And we go out of our way, including additional financial support, to try and attract qualified U.S. citizens to these programs, and it is a serious, serious challenge. And despite the fact that we fund them more generously than we want on average in international scheme at the same time, it's a real challenge.
Perhaps, of course, it's a delightful moment there as well.
Mr. Mitchell.
Well, since we're seeing the main area of doing business today, let me jump in with one of mine. I don't know if this story is really true or not, but it is a story that Chinese kids are told, and I suppose there is a point to it. The story is that silk technology left China. Because of depending on your point of view, a courageous or adventurous Chinese princess who carried the silk cocoons, the silk lining of cocoons, or something like that, and she snuck the cocoons in there and carried them down the silk road, enabling other countries to start a competing silk industry. And the reason why she so carefully hid those cocoons is because so Chinese children are told there is a death penalty imposed for exporting silk technology from China.
whether that's true or not, I thought I'd just share that story with you all as you consider exploring America. Now, for other countries, the world has progressed in many respects, but some of the old lessons, they are old lessons because there may be a grain of wisdom or not, as the case may be. And I just outgrew that story. Well, the story kind of speaks for itself. Before you all raise your hands to comment, I want to pitch something else to you, which is the way to enhance student financial aid at no cost to the taxpayer, and which is tied to bringing additionally qualified folks to the United States. Chris Cox and I proposed this in 1999, and we almost got it passed, but we got caught in a three-way squeeze at the plate, and it didn't quite pass, but we're running back up the flagpole. I just wanted you all to be aware of it. The proposal is to grant an additional quantum of H-1B visas. As you all know, businesses petition for the visas on behalf of the beneficiary. The petitioner would be required to make a payment to an accredited college or university in the amount of the yet existing program. Let's just call that $5,000. As you know, petitioners today, recruiters, pay $100,000 to $200,000 to buy an employee, and they qualify to find a qualified employee, pay the moving costs, and all the associated costs. So $5,000 a year is, on a comparative basis, chump change. And every high-tech operating executive right now is strongly in favor of this proposal. And lobbyists here in Washington sometimes seem slightly different too. The way this would work is that they would come to qualified universities, lay down their $5,000, you would certify that they had done so, and the immigration authorities would give expedited processing to their visa petition. And in this case, expedited processing would probably work, because most of the time, the folks that they're looking for are already at your institutions, and all the pre-clearances could have been done well in advance. I continue to think that this is a good idea, and we are going to pitch it up as part of a broader immigration package, and we have brought this to the attention of various educators and high-tech folks. Back in 1999 and 2000, the education community was very enthusiastic. The high-tech community at the operational level was very enthusiastic. At the lobbying level back in 1999, they called that an additional tax. We responded that it was not a tax, it was a voluntary payment. They seemed to have come around because 2007, no one's saying a T word anymore, but they do want credit for prior donations made. And our response has been, well, actually, we'd like to see fresh cash on the bottom of that, because we want to see that for college financial aid. And by the way, the legislation is drafted, we require you all to pass that on dollar for dollar to American students. So we just want to make them aware of that. We're not giving them any place they can and if they're business in that.
Ms. Rayburn. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. First, I'd like to mention that Cornell University's receive project in Puerto Rico, like a good example
scholarships for graduate students providing potential at the scientific grants in our country, so that no one in NASA and the rest of these organizations could actually provide scholarships to make sure that our people are being trained. And I think that it really would have to bring in students, foreign students, and independent slots rather than training Americans is a symbol of failure, not something we should be brilliant about.
The job of one of the things I particularly like about the purpose of our work is allowing us to present other sides of the story that needs to need to be presented by the right well saying that the world is bounded to. And at this point, we've heard a number of important insights and fascinating hearing about what is clearly going to be a growing trend, I think, with important implications in this area. Urgent final comments or questions from the panel, if the other members of the panel and the committee wish to submit comments, or if the members of our panel wish to, if our members of our panel wish to offer additional remarks, we appreciate very much your time and testimony. And we look forward to seeing you again, hopefully, down the road. And at this point, the committee stands adjourned. Thank you very much.
Thank you.